is civic leadership development. It is preparing Catholic professionals to lead out in the secular world, and that's what makes it unique from any TLI is the vision of Bishop Thomas Olmsted, and I am the person that had the privilege to execute the vision there in Phoenix. We have great hopes that we can do the same in Los Angeles, and that's why we invited you here today, so that you can learn a little bit more. But the best way for you to learn about the program is by hearing it from the graduates themselves. So I'm going to invite here to the front Jimmy Flores, Juan Ramirez, and
yet would improve my business life in a positive manner with a group that I would want to be affiliated with for life. TLI definitely did that plus more. I not only learned more about my faith in an intimate manner, but I met people that influenced me in a positive way that I can call friends for life. And it really helped me, especially when we're a startup, go through the motions. Stay positive and true to the right direction. So, thank you.
Thank you, Julie.
I'm Maria Escarcega. I'm the Safe Environment Coordinator for the Diocese of Phoenix. That is a new-ish position for me, so I actually did have a change of job after completing TLI. I'm born and raised in Arizona. I like to joke, or actually reality, I was half raised in Mexico. We went there all the time. I'm a product of homeschooling, and I have a lot of siblings, and I love it.
Juan Ramirez, I am from Yuma, Arizona. I grew up on the border right down in San Luis. And then after high school, moved to Phoenix, Tempe area, and went to school at ASU, got an engineering degree. And then a couple of years later, I just got bored and decided to go to law school. So now I do personal injury law.
In the audience among you, we have two other graduates who won't be in the panel today, but you're welcome to approach them as well. One of them won't raise her hand because she's doing a live video for us on Facebook, and the other one is Mickey in the back who's going to raise her hand for you. Tepeyac Leadership Initiative is an 18 weeks, 5-month program that takes place from the second week of February all the way to the third week of June. Here in Los Angeles, the program will meet Thursday nights from 7 to 10 p.m. here at Cathedral High School. The main commitment to do the program is those 18 weeks, and you'll be committing to coming here once a week. Once you start, it's back to back, but there's a break for Holy Week from 7 to 10 p.m., and participants are allowed to miss up to 3 sessions if they have to, but maybe you won't want to if you have to, and then you can still graduate for the program. Besides that, there is a 1-day retreat that takes place on a Saturday. That is the highlight of the program. People have talked about it as a transformative experience, and it really has been for many. So, my next question for the panel is, Tepeyac Leadership Initiative promises to give you both professional leadership development and spiritual growth. Could you tell me how the program has impacted your professional life and your spiritual life?
I think that in order to answer this question, I thought that I was a good Catholic growing up because, I'm Catholic 3 ways, Filipino, Mexican, and Polish. So so I was kind of, I went to church, I got confirmed, baptized, confirmed, but yeah, I still felt somewhat lost in the minutia of the secular world. So when joining TLI, I really didn't have as much expectation other than just learning more about my faith and connecting with others. However, the program and my with me spiritually got me to understand my faith a little bit more because of the logic behind the explanation, which growing up, going to church because I said so was kind of the thing that I was around, right? But when it comes to my spirituality, I think that it was strongly enhanced as well as enlightened because of the teachings that I understood within the class. And in my professional world, it actually gave me more confidence because I was able to just be myself, which means I can talk more about being a spiritual person and actually act and live like a spiritual person. You'd be surprised when you're talking to someone and you are at lunch and you say a quick prayer before you eat, people respect that. Or when you talk about your faith and you say, yeah, I actually can't meet on Sundays because I like to go to Mass on Sundays. I would just, in the past, think of an excuse, yeah, I just don't work Sundays, right? Be more open about your faith to yourself without indoctrinating someone else. And people respect that. So in the professional world, it's helped me tremendously. I was not only able to be myself, but I was able to connect with other Catholics that are very strong with their faith as well, that you'd be very surprised on who they are, especially in Phoenix, and I'm sure here in LA. And spiritually, I was definitely enlightened and enhanced from the knowledge that I learned.
As far as leadership goes, I've dedicated my life to social work about 6 years back. And then actually after TLI, this big life change, I decided to move out. I just felt that the world was a little toxic for where I was at spiritually and mentally. And I landed a job at the Roman Catholic Diocese of Phoenix. Can't get any more supportive than that in your Catholic faith. So you really had to buck up, straighten up, and then, fly exactly to where I wanted to go, right into Jesus' arms. So that was a wonderful transformation that came for me, a good gift that came from the faith and the fellowship and the formation that I was able to receive through TLI, both in my peers and in the mentors and just in the program. As far as spiritually speaking, I feel like we all feel pretty good with where we're at. But what's good about being Catholic is a constant hunger. I feel like the Catholic Church isn't very easy to always grasp. And I think that hunger has just been, now I'm even more hungry. I'm voracious about wanting to know more about the Catholic Church. And I had a wonderful conversation with somebody here about how it's difficult to be Catholic publicly. We get shamed, we get teased, do you really, you know, pray to all those people, what goes on in your head, and then I'm not even talking about all the jokes and scandal that end up happening. We've all been accustomed to it, rolling over and just saying, yeah, okay. And there came a point, I used to be really outspoken about my faith, and there came a point where I just didn't want to get beaten down anymore. I don't want to talk about it, I might bring it up, I definitely did all of my church stuff, you know, I went to confession and I would have friends, but it was, I didn't bring anybody with me. I didn't evangelize. And I didn't realize how much I missed it until I went through this program, until I was able to learn more, the encyclicals, I mean, the beauty of the church, the depth. We have such a gift. And it really reinvigorated my spirit for being out there and being open. And I'm not afraid to say I'm Catholic, that I go to church and I'm pro-life, and that I vote pro-life, and that my friends know that. And I'm against contraception, living, you know, together, all these things. I am no longer afraid of it. And I think TLI was just that perfect push for me.
Thank you, Maria. For me, the way it affected me and my professional life, I think it's really strengthened that spirit of service. I've always had a desire to serve my community and to help out. But I think for a little while, it was kind of lagging. And the way it helped was making me more aware of my colleagues, the needs, and also the not the spiritual growth, but the professional growth of the people in my office as well. Sometimes you get consumed by your workload and your own career and developing yourself, and you forget to develop those around you, your team. So I think going through this program, seeing the examples of all the leaders, the speakers, amazing speakers that come and speak through this program, and seeing how they live their life and how they're always thinking of their family and their co-workers, the people in the community, it's like, huh, you know, should pay more attention to that. And since I was in the program, it, I've noticed it change because I am more aware of what's going on with the people in my office. I ask them, what are your goals? What do you want to do? What do you like? How can you change things in the office so you can experience, gain some new experience? And slowly I've seen the culture of the office change to a more positive culture. And that's been amazing. It's been great, and I hope to continue doing that. And in turn, it also helps me, you know? It just pays dividends. Because once everybody's feeling better about themselves, they're enjoying their career, the job, everybody benefits from that. So, and I can share, if you guys have more questions, I can share more stuff later on.
Thank you, Juan. So, Tepeyac Leadership Initiative is, of course, a leadership program. So, what has TLI taught you about leadership?
I think TLI taught me a lot more about faith in others, or faith in myself and faith in others, trusting in God, trusting in Jesus Christ, that if it's truly good and if you truly want it, God will provide. And especially in my business, where I was transforming from a scrappy startup where I just only used to have sales guys, like that Wolf of Wall Street thing, you know, just go and sell, to more of a corporate environment where I had to rely on other people to get a job done that I had no idea how to do myself. And going through TLI, really understanding my faith more and growing in my faith, I was able to relax. Sometimes my executives say I relax too much. but really put, you know, God in charge. And stay in my lane and just know that what I became or who I am, what God made me to be, focus on that and believe that it will just work out. That doesn't mean to just close your eyes and drive the car. You still have to keep your eyes open. But believe in yourself and believe in your faith, and you will go ahead and find the answers that you're looking for. So I think if anything in leadership that I've learned from TLI, it was a strengthening of my faith God and myself that I then reciprocated to my organization.
I managed a team prior to this. I had 8 employees directly underneath me, 200 families, and so on and so forth, and a third of a program. So I actually experienced management, which I thought was interesting, and I thought, oh man, this is great. I love having a team underneath me. I love seeing personal growth and personal development. And I just really missed the spiritual component of it. And then this, I think what I really learned about leadership is that it has to be done with virtue. Because what I was doing was managing, right? I was managing a team. I was doing numbers. I was at zero. You know, I was in the black, I guess, for in social work terms. We don't really deal with money. We deal with families and feelings. But we were doing a great job. But I think what I really missed was just the virtue that I just needed to beef it up, I guess. I needed to be better for them. And I needed to understand that leadership has to do with humility, it has to do with prudence, temperance, I mean, everything. And one of the wonderful things, I mean, I'm going to go back to that retreat, because I had done my temperament test, and who here hasn't been on Catholic Match and been tempted to do some of those silly little things that are on there, so you know so much about yourself, but what do you do with it? This is an opportunity for you to learn what to do with it, how to apply it, and the best part, as a professional, I love what Bishop Olmsted said about this program, is that I want you to go out and be great. That doesn't mean don't take the promotion. That doesn't mean go get hungry, go make money, go build the church. And this whole time I've been thinking that vulnerability and humility means I have to be meek and humble and not be this, you know, be a quieter person than what I am. And I feel like that helped me spread my wings and understand that I was made this way to go be a force of nature. And I think this program and the way that woken that spirit inside of me. My hope is that it would in you too, through learning your temperament and understanding yourself through virtuous leadership and how each one of us can go out there and impact the world.
Yeah, I echo everything Maria said. I mean, that's what we learned at the virtuous leadership weekend. And it's true, it was an eye-opening experience because, again, just like she was saying, oftentimes as a Catholic, maybe a lot of it, or our culture, just you think that you're supposed to be humble and meek. But no, we're meant to do great things. Obviously not be arrogant, but with the spirit of service, right? And I saw that time and time again from the speakers that we had and them explaining how they live their lives. And it's just the great examples that they set. The discipline, waking up early, doing prayer, doing exercise, making time for the family, all that. I was like, wow, I don't do a lot of that stuff. I do it every once in a while. And just seeing how they're consistent. Obviously, they don't always have the perfect day, but the consistency, it's like you keep at it, day after day after day after day, and build those new habits. So that, to me, is what helped in terms of being a leader. But I also don't think as I'm going to be a leader. It's more, for me, it's more, how can I serve? And through that service, help others. I guess through that service, I am being a leader, but I don't really think of myself as Juan the leader. You know, it's just what you do, right? And also a little bit of the time management for sure. Like again, seeing how they live their lives and the discipline, and me forcing myself and reminding myself, if I want to accomplish great things, this is what I have to do. This is the formula. It's a proven formula. All these people are doing it. I can do it too.
Thank you, Juan. One of the greatest assets of the program is the team of speakers that we have been able to assemble in Phoenix, the top Catholic speakers in Arizona, and we are blessed to have some nationally well-known speakers such as Alan Sears, Nick Nikas. You might recognize some of the names from our website. Here in Los Angeles, God has blessed us, and we have been able to replicate that. We already have assembled a beautiful lineup of speakers for the Los Angeles program. We're done. We have our speakers. We have the program ready to go. What we need is people to go through the program. And that's why you were invited to come here to learn more about it. So at this point, we're going to open it up for questions. Who wants to start with a question?
Yeah, I was wondering if you could comment on the nature and content progression throughout the podcast.
The content.
The content progression throughout
sure,
the podcast.
Sure. Maria, you want to talk about that?
So the content consists of encyclicals. Christopher is very kind to professionals. He makes the readings very easy, even though they're very heady and difficult. And I kind of call it like a little bit of a cliff notes. Obviously, the expectation is that you dive into it, right? This is just a teaser. You're supposed to go and be hungry for more. But then we come back and we pick it apart, and we have speakers that are relevant to the encyclicals that the popes have put out, that the great saints, the doctors of the church. You go learning step by step all of these big things that the Catholic Church has, these wonderful things that we have to offer, and all of the intelligence that we have built over the 2,000x years that we have, and we get to pick it apart and learn from it and then apply it in kind of a business type of sense. So if we talk about Catholics in the public square, we'll have somebody who is a Catholic, an active one, and then talks about their work in the public square. And then you're supposed to come up with your own questions to really dive deeper into it, and there's some peer discussions in there, but it's wonderful. I like to learn, I don't really love to read, so for me it was really, really awesome, and now I like to read, so there we go.
Are you a chance to add, Jimmy?
Yeah.
I just want to say one thing, to make sure that you get a clear answer. We talk about things such as education, healthcare, immigration, business, government, philanthropy, board service. The church has written about everything. Mm-hmm. Where do we get our content? From the wisdom of the Catholic Church. We just make it relevant.
And to add off of that, so each week has a theme, and all three speakers, I don't know how many speakers you have.
Three per session.
They all service that theme. So they're subject matter experts in those specific themes. And the readings that you'll get directly from the church are around those themes and go into deep explanations and examples. And then when we have the speakers talk about it, you're going to want to write down questions that you have, and you're going to go ahead and ask those questions directly to each one of the speakers to get more clarity. So you're learning essentially through immersion as well as through asking your own questions on what you want to figure out. And then you also receive content in a book. You mean the it was like a 3-5 ring book or 5 inches? I mean, it's a huge binder that you're collecting every single week. And these papers are not coming directly from the church. The speakers are creating the content for you directly.
They're reading it.
The PowerPoint.
Yeah,
the PowerPoint speakers. Some speakers. So when you talk about content each week and the speakers that are involved, you're getting some high-level content from CEOs, from directors, from people that are subject matter experts in those fields, which was the most, that was my favorite thing. Okay.
No, I have nothing to add.
All right. Next question. Anything about the application process? Any questions about the commitment? Typically, those are the ones that get brought up. The cost? What would you like to know? Yes.
I'd like to know how you heard about TLI and what, how you made the decision to do the program.
In my experience, I heard it from Christopher over there. I was at a young Catholic professionals event, and he was there with had a table out there, and so I went to chat with him. And he told me a little bit about the program. I was like, oh, awesome, that's great, because that's what I'm looking for. That's why I'm here at YCP, because I'm looking for a group of Catholic professionals, or just Catholics in general, who are out there practicing their faith and unabashedly, you know, who live their values in the public sector and private sector. And because oftentimes, you know, the times that we live in nowadays, everybody's really quiet about that stuff, especially because Catholic values are contrary to mainstream values right now. So oftentimes you just feel alone. It's like, does anybody else believe what I believe? And who have the courage to live out their faith? And when he told me about that, I was like, yeah, we want to encourage more people to do that and be involved in perhaps a run for office or be on boards and stuff like that. I was like, hey, I'm your guy. And I want to meet more people like that. And so that for me was the main thing that attracted me to the group.
So at this point in the Phoenix, we have a growing group of alumni that has become an association, the Phoenix part of, that have come from the program. The program went from being a diocesan program, turned into a 501c3, and now it's a non-profit organization, and it is that organization that's bringing it to Los Angeles. So we have a board of very well-known, respected, seasoned Catholic leaders in Phoenix. We have the mentors. We have a great group of stakeholders in Phoenix. But in Phoenix, we started much in the way that we're starting in Los Angeles, which was my assistant and I. Mm-hmm. And we hope to build another TLI family in Los Angeles, which will be made up of the team of speakers, the mentors, the graduates from the program, as we continue to build this, what we hope to be a national organization, a national community of Catholic leaders.
Yes.
Average class size or cohort size that you guys are hoping to have here in LA?
Average is 35 people. Yeah, we're looking for the right people in the program. So there's no magical number, but it has turned out to be about 30 to 35 people.
And the cost, is it, will it be different from your Phoenix model here in Los Angeles?
The cost in Phoenix is $800 and in Los Angeles is $1,000. That costs us a lot more to bring it to Los Angeles.
Right.
Very flexible participants campaign, installments, whatever it takes, we'll work with them. What we want them is to experience TLI. All right.
What is the application process?
The application process is you go online. Everything is there. It's mostly your contact information. Probably the key section is the essay questions. I think it's 5 essay questions that you want to take your time. Maybe put them in a Word document, take your time, then copy and paste. Submit it through. You're going to need at least one letter of reference from somebody, Catholic or non-Catholic, somebody that can talk about your character. You upload your resume, and I think that's it. Just submit it through, and then you're invited for an interview. You go through the interview process. In Phoenix, it has gotten very competitive. Every year, we've had at least twice the number of applicants per space spots in the program. So we don't know yet what Los Angeles will be like, but you're encouraged to put together the best application, the strongest applications you can.
What reason would you have for rejecting someone?
Let me answer that the following way. There's two things that we're looking for. These are the key things that we tell the admissions committee to look for when they interview and when they review the applications. Heart and action. The applicant's heart has to be in the right place. What that means is that they need to be open and ready to receive what we want to share with them. We want people that love their church, love the teachings of the church, whether they know them or understand them all or not. You are not looking for level or depth of knowledge, but submission to the magisterium of the Catholic Church. Their heart is open to receive what we're going to give them, and action, that they are ready to put into action what we're going to give them. Our program is very action-oriented. Each graduate graduates with his or her own individual commitment to leadership. So we really don't want anybody that wants to take this program just to feel good about themselves. Like, there are so many other programs that do that. Our program is very action-oriented. So heart and action. I don't know if that comes to the Isaac, and there's another one over there.
That actually leads into my question. Were any of you involved in ministry work before the program and now after the program?
Not at all.
Maria?
Yes.
What?
Yes, I was involved in RCA for several years.
Thank you. There was another question
for
that here.
Yeah, you answered it, but I have another one. Why did you choose LA and what do you hope?
Well, LA is a great place to start. Largest our size is in the United States. There's a lot of talent here, and we needed to put together a team of speakers. So it was easier at a large our size. I'll tell you right now, down the road, we're looking at Houston, for example, because it's another large our size. There's going to be a lot of potential speakers there, and also potential participants. And then we have a lot of, I didn't know our special comments before we decided to bring the program. But we had a lot of friends in common. Bishop Olsen and Archbishop Gomez are good friends. So there were so many people that had already told Archbishop Gomez about the program that when the day I met with him, he was ready to tell me, bring it over. That's really how it went. Yes, Tim.
Could you give us some examples of the commitments to action that some people have made for this program?
Sure. I'll give you some, and then maybe I'll let each of the participants. A few that stand out to me are this real estate agent who is now working on a project for low-income families, which is he went and looked at. He's now talking to funders, investors, contractors, and he's doing this thing that he felt called to do. He says it happened the day of the retreat. He says he heard our mother telling that that's what he said. He said he heard her say, "Build for my people." And that's what he's doing. We had this other gentleman that felt called to put together and start a theater company that conveys, do plays that convey a positive message. He's already had his first play. I talk about those two examples a lot because they impact me a lot. But we also have some pro-life initiatives. We have two people who are right now preparing themselves to run for public office, which is something that we encourage, by the way, for whatever political affiliation you have, so long as you are attacking first. So those are some of the commitments that we've seen. If you go to the website and check out the section level leadership, it has a whole list, and there's a lot of very beautiful stuff that you will find out. But maybe you guys can briefly say what your commitment was.
Sure. My commitment was to expand the populace, the TLI. If they didn't have the financial opportunity to join, I wanted to create a scholarship fund for people that were on the fence, and the only thing stopping them was the financial commitment.
And that's coming.
My commitment, I'm actually a part of a young professionals board for Catholic Charities, and we're connecting with other young professional boards and bringing them and asking them to come volunteer and donate to various organizations and parts of Catholic Charities. So we're hosting a toy drive in December. We meet quarterly, so, and I plan to do more, as I hope. So.
Thank you. What?
For me is to serve the youth and also to engage the whole hot topic going on with the transgender ideology. So that was my commitment.
Bring a little more clarity in terms of the ideology of the body. Any other questions? Yes, we have one in the back.
A couple of questions. First of all, for someone who is already pretty well educated in terms of Catholic social teaching,
something for everybody in the program. We receive people, applicants, we're looking for hard of action, like I said earlier, regardless of level of formation. Some of the participants have gone through Catholic school all their life and Catholic university and have tremendous formation already. And some of the participants, quite honestly, didn't get much after their first communion or confirmation. And each of them was able to benefit. The two profiles that we most often see, and there's a lot in between, but the extremes, applying for the program, are this Catholic who is very engaged with his professional career, identifies his or herself as a Catholic, but doesn't really do much with it. He's not involved with his faith, doesn't really connect his Catholic faith with his professional life. And on the other end, we have these Catholic professionals who see their career, quite honestly, as a means to provide for themselves. Clock in, clock out, but really love ministry and serving at the church, right? And they don't understand that their career should be their primary field of mission. So both of them have something to gain from the program. Does that help a little?
Yeah.
Okay. If we don't have any more questions, then we're going to open it up for just a little more mingling and networking. You're welcome to.